Hi, my name is Dr. Raashi Khatri Panjabi. I am a specialist in orofacial pain, temporomandibular disorders, which is basically jaw joint disorders, and headaches at PD Hinduja Hospital. I'm very excited that you guys are here because obviously you're here because you want to make your life better. You want to improve the quality of your living rather than the quality of your life. And we are together, we're here to figure out how to recognize and eliminate your headaches. I'm very happy you're here because finally you have decided to take charge of your life and figure out how you're going to eliminate your headaches rather than try to subdue them or the symptoms of the headaches using conventional painkillers. So here goes. I'm going to try to keep it as fun as possible because that's the only way you and me are going to figure out what's happening with your headaches, right? Let's ask everyone a question. In fact, if you're with your friends, with your families, you have your WhatsApp phone around as well. You can ask people, has anyone not had a headache in their life? Have you had a headache? I'm sure the answer is going to be yes. And the answer is yes because headaches are the most commonly experienced symptom by almost every single person in human civilization. Unfortunately, if I come to your house and I ask you that do you have a blood pressure machine, you'll probably say no. But if I ask you do you have any painkiller, you're probably going to make a nice thali in front of me and give me like 15 bowls of 15 different types of painkillers. And you'll be like, here they are. And at this point, we need to start thinking. Let's step back a little bit. Headaches. Where exactly is your head? Most people that I ask this question to, where's your head? They generally land up saying that it's this portion going from their eyebrows all the way to the top of their forehead. Your head is actually the part of your body which goes all the way from here to here. So when you do say you have a headache, it can be in any portion in this region and not just subjected to the area above your eyebrows. Most of us have experienced pain, physical pain at some point in life. Yes, I'm guessing your answer is yes as well. What do we do when we have that pain? We get disturbed. We feel terrible that we have this pain in our lives and we often feel miserable. Unfortunately, we forget to realize that pain is your body's only way to communicate with you. If I fall off this chair right now, and I hope that doesn't happen, and if I break my hand, till I won't experience pain, I won't realize that my hand is broken. Even if a machhar comes into this very pristine and clean room and bites me, till there is pain, I won't realize that there is an insect invading my body. Even if I touch a hot iron, till there isn't any pain, I'm not going to realize that the iron is hot. So basically, pain is your body's only way of communicating with you and letting you know that there is something going on that needs your attention. It is a communication. And more often than enough, it is an ask for protection for a part of your body that requires your attention. It is your body's structure, the physical part of you, asking you to give it some amount of due and look at where it's coming from. But what do we do when it gets unpleasant or when it doesn't get convenient? We often just pop in a conventional painkiller that is going to subdue the symptom of the pain rather than addressing what is the source of the pain. You and me are not going to do that. You and me are today going to figure out what is the root cause of the pain, what is the root cause of the ache, whether it be anywhere in your hand or in your head. So your headache is actually your body trying to communicate with you and tell you that something is going on that needs your attention. And more often than enough, that headache actually starts at a source very far away from where you actually feel it. Let me give you an example. If there's a little baby that keeps crying because the baby has a diaper that's full, and you keep thinking, because you're not understanding the communication, that the baby is crying because the baby is hungry, you will feed the baby what it requires and the baby will keep quiet for precisely 15 minutes. But eventually, the diaper keeps getting fuller and fuller and fuller and you will have to deal with all that shit, right? So similarly, your body is giving you a signal of a headache or a pain to let you know that something is going on. And you can try to placate it or look after it in different ways. But till you get to the actual root cause, you're achieving nothing. Eventually, you will have to deal with all that shit. So you and me are here to figure out what it is that your body is trying to communicate with you so that we can look after that and eliminate your headaches. So let's go forward and let me try to tell you what are the fun ways we can look at headache. I know you may not find it fun. You may be dealing with a headache right now. You may be looking for that painkiller right now, but hold on. Give me the next 20 minutes and let's try to figure out why you have the headache. You can send in your questions. Anything that you are urgently wanting to ask me, type it onto your Facebook account in the comments. Send it across and I will answer them. I promise you we'll try to get to it as fast as we can. Now we all know that pain comes into our body only if there is some potential danger or actual danger that is going on in the body. We have already answered that, right? So imagine if I am going to get, say, a fever or if there is an infection in my body, of course there will be pain associated with it. So if I am getting some kind of bacterial infection or a viral infection, my body will produce acute pain. It may be accompanied with some kind of inflammation, but eventually the bacteria is out of my system, the virus fades away out of my system, and the pain goes away. So this is pain of an acute nature. So you could get headaches, which could be because of an acute natured pain. However, this is not what we are talking about today. We are talking today about chronic pain. The pain that continues to bother you and take away from your quality of life despite there not being any noxious stimulus. Now that is so weird to even hear that there is nothing actually that's going on, but your body produces headaches for no apparent reason. Now all of this sounds like a lot of information and jargon, but at the end of the day, you're sitting in front of me, clutching your head and asking me, how the hell do I look after my headaches? You're giving me unnecessary information that I'm not interested in. So I thought, let's take it easier. Let's take a step back and look at the most common kinds of headaches that we mostly see and see what they are about. Now, this lecture that I'm talking to you guys is not for doctors. Hi, sir. Hi, ma'am. If you're looking at this lecture, this is not for you. This is for somebody who's sitting at home and battling with their headaches every single day. So I'm going to speak in simple language. I'm going to be as easy as possible and help you guys figure your headaches out. First, where do you get your headaches? Do you get them here? Do you get them here? Do you get them here? Do you get them at the back of your head? Is there associated neck ache? You need to start asking yourself, whether it's one-sided, two-sided, does my eye hurt? Does it make me feel better when somebody massages certain points of my head? So location is key. Take a piece of paper, write down where do you feel your headaches? Because if I don't know where it's starting from or where you're feeling it, we don't know how to treat it. Second is, how often do you get your headaches? Do you get them every day? Do you get them for a couple of hours? Does it go on forever? Now that we have this pick pad down, we ask a very important question. What makes my headaches worse and what makes my headaches better? I'm sure most of the married people are going to say that my headaches started from once I got married, but let's keep that for another day. So, a lot of you are going to look at me and tell me that I think my headaches are related to stress. They're related to a lot of tension that goes on in my life. My maid doesn't come, I have a headache. We will talk about that. Believe me, there'll be loads of you like that, and we will try to figure out today whether your headaches start from stress or they start from a very different reason, but they are exacerbated by stress. I'll give you a small example. Now imagine you're sitting in Goa with a beautiful glass of pina colada in your hand, staring at the ocean, and you suddenly get an appendix pain. Versus you're sitting at home, there's no maid. Your child has an exam tomorrow. it's a terrible day, your boss has just shouted at you, and you have a headache. Now, the quality of the headache continues to remain the same whether you're in Goa or whether you're sitting at home. Possibly, the type of the headache remains the same as well. What changes is what you perceive out of it. Your appendix will pain in Goa and in Bombay, but you may feel in Goa that your appendix pain is a 9 on 10. Versus in Bombay, it might feel like a 10 on 10 with all the stresses that you're going through. But has your appendix pain started because of you being in Bombay? Absolutely not. All the stress that you were feeling, has it led to your appendix getting infected? Absolutely not. Similarly, your headaches don't start because of stress, but pre-existing issues which can lead to headaches may feel worse because of stress. I will get to that again a little more shortly. We are going to talk today about the two most common types of headaches. One is the M word, migraines. And the second is tension type headaches. Again, not the tension that you're feeling here. So hold on to your horses. Keep those questions coming in the comments, but wait till we finished and you'll have more clarity, I'm sure. Let's talk about migraines now. Now, if by a show of hands, you're not showing to me right now, but you can be honest to yourself. If you are a chronic headache patient, has anyone told you you have migraines, or do you believe you have migraines, or have you taken migraine medications? Have you? I see those hands going up. Yeah, that's you. You're the one. Now, migraines are a particular kind of primary headaches which we generally see more in women, less in men. But believe me, there are lots of men with migraines as well. These headaches are often seen unilaterally. That means they're on one side of the head, but they can be on the other side as well. And more often than enough, they're characterized by almost a throb. You'll feel like a thak, 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 thak going on inside your head. I want to explain to you why a person gets migraines, because it's often a stigma if somebody comes and tells you, oh, I have migraines and I know I have to live with it for the rest of my life. Actually, you don't, because there are ways to look after it. But I want to explain to you why you get your migraines. Now, let's think of your brain as being this nice juicy log that is sitting inside your skull. It does sit inside your skull. Your brain receives all its blood supply by arteries and veins, which are crisscrossed almost like lace, like crochet, around your brain, right? So that's how you get the blood supply to your brain. Think about all those arteries and veins like pipes, like the garden pipe that we use to water our plants. Now, if there was a garden pipe all running across my brain, think of it that every 1 minute, 1 liter of water goes through this garden pipe, which is used to water my plants. For patients who are migrainers, this garden pipe suddenly, instead of being this thick, becomes as thin as a straw. So instead of carrying 1 liter of water across, it can carry now only 500 ml. So in the next minute, there is 1 liter coming in and a surplus of 500 ml that wasn't able to pass through. And the next minute, there's that and the surplus that's left over. But the pump or the tap which is pushing the water through is bound to force that water through. So what happens is all that excess pressure of water is felt over here going across the pipe as a boom, 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 boom. And unfortunately, that boom, boom, boom is what you hear inside of your head going as a... But why does this pipe become thinner? What can make it thinner? A multitude of triggers can do that. There could be food triggers like wine, chocolate, certain cheeses. There could be loads and loads of hormonal triggers for women and men. and there could just be the random trigger, which we are difficult to pinpoint. But migraines can be helped. Gone are the days when you have to rely just on painkillers. When you know the problem is in the pipe, all you have to do is open that pipe out, which allows for the blood to pass through faster, and whoops, there goes your migraines and the theory that your migraines are not curable. So anybody who tells you that your migraines are not curable, give them this theory and tell them that they are. I also want to talk to you all about another kind of headache. Now, this headache is something that resembles migraines a lot. It is something that is so similar to migraines that 90% of people who have their migraines actually misdiagnose themselves. And I'm saying misdiagnose themselves because most people who have headaches try to self-treat rather than seek help for it. Am I not right? Did you not do that? But the point is that anybody who thinks they have a migraine needs to go through this entire questionnaire and figure out if what they are actually going through is a migraine or it is this second type of headache that we are going to talk about. I'm going to tell you about the human body a little bit more before I get to that headache. Now, for all of us, you and me, our head is that little globe that sits above our neck, right? Now, for you, me, and every single person in the world, the head, the human head, weighs around 10 kg, plus and minus few grams because of the weight of your brain. But the human head, which weighs 10 kgs, is attached to the body by means of a neck. Now, the spine is what connects your head to the rest of your body. Your spine starts at the back of your neck and goes all the way to your butt. But in your neck region, there are only 6 rings of bones that connect this head to the rest of your body. Now, if I were to take something so heavy and put it on something which was so straight, what do you think would happen? Gravity would take over, and that heavy head should technically fall in all directions. But our head is not like a Jaipur ka gudiya, right? It's not bobbing all around. We're able to sit up straight. And the reason we're able to sit up straight is because our body has been beautifully made by the Creator to have a lattice work of muscles which start far away from the head. So there are muscles that start from our chest, from our arms, going as down as our lower back. These muscles go across our body, crisscross at our neck, and go and take anchorage on top of our head. So if I do something as simple as this, and I know you can see it for me right now, there is a muscle that actually stretches all the way from my arms to my neck, to the back of my neck, goes behind my ear, and goes and gets attached on top of my head. And mind you, that's only one muscle. If I do it the other side, this muscle is stretching while this one is contracted. To keep my head up straight, there is a multitude of muscles, as many as hundreds of them, that work in close combination with each other just to keep my head up upright and just to be sitting this way. Now imagine, our muscles are supposed to be elastic, loose, flexible, easy to move, and that's what allows us the ease and flexibility of doing whatever we need to. If I ask you, move the muscles on the top of your head. Impossible to do that, right? Can you move them? Of course, you can move your facial muscles, but can you move the muscles on top of your head? You can't, because the muscles on top of my head just provide a meeting point or a point where all the other muscles from far away from my body are attached. Now, for some reason, imagine if this muscle, the trapezius muscle, but just let's call it the rectangular muscle right now. If this muscle, which was starting here and going across my neck all the way to the top of my head, and if it was supposed to be elastic, loose, flexible, for some reason this muscle gets compressed. Now suddenly this muscle is not as long as it was. And also, now this muscle is not as flexible, mobile, or being able to do what it needs to. And mind you, this is just a piece of paper that I'm using for reference. Now, if this muscle goes into this point of contraction, we call these tiny, tiny nuggets of tightness as myofascial trigger points. Forget the big words. What it is that it's a point of tightness that exists in the center of the muscles. As a trigger would. Now, all of you know that a gun has a trigger, right? If you press the trigger of a gun, the bullet pops out. Similarly, if any kind of activity leads to this muscle getting compressed or leads to an activation or a trigger of this point, the pain will spread till where this muscle is attached. So although you may have muscle spasms or trigger points over here or over here, you will feel the pain extending till where the muscle is attached, which more than enough of times will be felt over here, with some amount of deep, dull achiness, even over here. Now, these headaches can be debilitating because these headaches will never respond to migraine medication because they're not migraines. These headaches, often then enough, will lead to a person feeling constantly heavy, not fresh, fatigued, because at the end of the day, it is muscles which are fatigued and in spasm, and the pain will often start traveling. So a patient may tell you, maybe you feel the same, that some days I feel the pain here, some days it is here, some days it is here, some days it is here. And most of the patients who have this kind of a headache, at the risk of sounding crazy, stop telling people that it hurts. And they trundle through life, leading a lesser quality of what they can imagine life to be and what they can make out of life because of this kind of debilitating pain. These headaches are very easy to look after. But the easiest and the simplest thing you need to do right now is get your tools out, no medical equipment that's fancy, and start feeling the pain and see if you have any lumps at the back of your head, at the front of your neck, over here, and even on your face. You will be very, very shocked, but these headaches are known as cervicogenic headaches or tension type headaches, not because of the tension inside of your head, but because of the tensile forces that work on these muscles and which can take away from you and give you the worst headaches ever. Most patients mistake this kind of headache to be something as simple as migraines. So different, but yet so same. The treatments are so, so different, but once mistaken, it is very difficult to figure out what's going on. Now, I have given you a lot of food for thought, but I want to give you very, very small snippets of why this can happen, why we can get this kind of muscle disorders which can lead to headaches which mimic migraines. One of the simplest thing is people who have chronic frontal sinusitis. Frontal sinusitis is the sinus which is often felt over here as being full. People who have frontal sinusitis have a tendency to sit like this, which allows for the airway to open up and improves breathing. But at the end of the day, it leads to a neck muscle spasm. So instead of sitting like this, you go into what is called a classic forward head posture. And the people who also go into classic forward head posture are more often than enough computer engineers or people who spend long times of time on their computer, even surgeons, dentists, a lot of people who are into intricate work on the desks, architect, people who are constantly on their desks, definitely can get this kind of headache as well as people who severely grind their teeth and people who have some amount of jaw dysfunction. Now this is, in short, two of the most common headaches that we do see. Now, if I had to tell you a lot about every kind of headache, I'll probably be sitting here for 9 years. I would love to, but if you guys want to listen to more of the different types of headaches, you can get in touch with Hinduja Hospital and we'll be happy to do more of that. But right now, since you all have been sending a million questions, let's answer them. So I'm going to ask my team to just give your questions across to me and we will answer them for you. I have a couple of questions which have come in here. So if I can have a look at them. So Avantika has written that I get stress headaches, whether during a viva or after an exam, during colleges or an important meeting day. Anxiety leads to headaches, temples, forehead, everything aches. Hi Avantika, thank you for sending in your question. I hope you have understood a little bit of about how stress doesn't start headaches, but how stress can worsen pre-existing headaches. Having said that, what I have realized, having worked with a lot of patients across all age groups, is that muscle spasms, which are felt in the neck, often worsen when there are students who are sitting down for prolonged periods of time and studying, and these kind of spasms can also lead to headaches. So what you may be attributing to stress may actually be coming from a further worsening of your neck during exam times. Most of us in our body, we tend to tighten our muscles or compress our muscles when we are put in a stressful condition, which actually works inversely at our headaches, because it actually worsens our headaches a lot more. So what I am going to recommend to you is, rather than trying to look at stress as a causative factor, I want you to actually self-examine your muscles. And let me know if you have muscle spasms over there, because if you look after those spasms, then even if you have stress in your life, which I'm sure you will, darling, stress is what you make out of life. So if you look after those neck muscles, your stress actually will not bother your muscles enough to give you a headache. I hope that helped you as well. Now, Aditi from Bombay has written, pre-pregnancy, I used to get throbbing unilateral migraines. Today, the headaches are still unilateral, but more dull. What could be the cause? Aditi, you are absolutely right. You have actually given us a very, very big clue. In pregnancy, there is a shift in the hormones, which is why you may have bettered your migraines. Yes, unfortunately, you did have a hormonal migraine before your pregnancy and you still have them right now. It's just that a shift or a balance of hormones during your pregnancy led to you feeling them less during the pregnancy period, but you do have migraines. Sometimes what happens is that chronic migraines can also be accompanied by muscle disorders or cervical headaches, as we spoke about them. So it will benefit you if we can differentiate for you and look after both these things separately. Now, migraines have different kinds of medical treatments, the least of which is to take away your triggers, the best of which is to actually give you medication specific for migraines, which could either be used, if your migraines are very few, we could do a mild abortive therapy of migraines to abort your headache before it becomes really, really bad, or we could do a preventive migraine therapy where we give you a tiny, tiny, tiny dose of medication to make sure that you never get a migraine. So we can do both of these along with evaluating you to see if you do have muscle conditions which are leading to the dull achiness and the occasional throbs. So thank you for your question and I hope that made sense to you. So we have Gayatri who has asked, how is acidity connected to headaches? Gayatri, that's a great question, because a lot of patients tell me that we feel better the second we throw up. Now, there are a different category of headaches which are associated with nausea, which are associated with increase in acidity. In fact, for a lot of migraineurs and chronic migraineurs, they give acidity as their first signal. I would like to add something on top of this. Once you rule out whether the kind of headache or the quality of headache you have is migrainous in nature, then if there is a migrainous nature to that and the acidity is coming only during a migraine attack, absolutely that needs to be looked after separately from a migraine point of view. However, if you're a non-migraineur and you get these headaches regularly, maybe even couple of times a week as a deep, dull, achy pain, which when you throw up feels better, or which are associated with acidity, it may make sense for us to find out what exactly is going on in your body which is leading to the acidity. There are a lot of chronic acidity patients, and in these cases we find out that the correlation between the muscle pain and the acidity may lie in a low-grade thyroid condition, which when diagnosed can look after both these things successfully. So absolutely, we also need to figure out if there is a mild digestive disorder or maybe a food allergy which is leading to acidity and the headache concurrently. So you're right, there is a lot of acidity in patients seen with headaches, but it is as wide scope as saying that every person who gets a headache also may get a fever. These are symptoms, but getting to the root cause is what's going to help you figure out what's happening. Till we don't figure out the root, we will never be able to give you a cure. Symptomatically looking after it will not lead to complete expulsion of both of them from your life. So thank you for the question, and it's a very, very good one. Payal from Bombay has said, how do I identify triggers, as at one point of time there may be many things working together, and do I need to actually take a lot of things out of my life? Payal, for all patients who talk about triggers, I always say one thing. Let's first figure out what is the kind of headache you have. I've seen many, many patients who are non-migraineurs, but who believe that they may be getting it because of food triggers, giving up 90% of their life and things that they enjoy because they believe that they need to do that in order for the headaches to get better. I don't think so. Once we have identified what is the kind of your headache, we may realize that it is not a migraine, but a food allergy which is aggravating your frontal sinus, which is eventually leading to a muscular spasm. In those cases, taking care of the triggers which are commonly known for migraines will not give you the relief that you're looking for. So always remember that getting to the source and the correct diagnosis is paramount. Do not take out all the foods that are important to you, because that is not going to work. We have different tests. We also have certain food allergies and body testing which can help us figure out what is the exact thing that may not or work for you. Let me give you an example. There was a gentleman who came to me. He's 70 years old and he told me that I have migraines, but I don't know what I'm supposed to give up because I have had 50 years of a beautiful life and right now I'm frightened to put anything inside my mouth, which is not fun for him and it's not fun for me to hear as well, because I want him to enjoy life, right? Everything should come with joy and ease. And what we found out after doing a very detailed study of his headaches with him was that he wasn't giving any signs and symptoms of a migraine at all. And on examining him and doing a multitude of tests, including one to check his nose out, we found that he actually was allergic to lycra. Now, how strange is that? And the lycra is in the polyfill in his pillow. And the lycra was giving him a allergic rhinitis, which is actually a blocked nose, because of which his entire forehead and the sinus behind it, which is your frontal sinus, was blocked. It was jammed with mucus. And because of it being so jammed, his body responded. He wasn't able to sit up straight like this and breathe. He became into a terrible snorer. His wife and he were sleeping in different rooms after almost 50 years of being married. And we figured that because all of this was so jammed, he started compensating and accommodating for the lack of being able to breathe from his nose by sitting like this. And in sitting like this and sleeping in weird postures, sometimes with two or three pillows with his hand tucked inside below the pillows, his neck muscles started reacting and started compressing, leading to a mild beginning of spondylitis. So imagine, he came to me having let go of all his food triggers and thinking that he was a migraineur, but having looked after the food allergy and having looked after the neck spasms, he's not had a migraine in over a year. His wife and he are now having a third or a fourth honeymoon in on some cruise somewhere. So hi, if you're listening to this as well, and thank you for being our example. I won't take his name, but thank you. And I hope, Payal, that answers your question too. Figure out what it is and don't give up on life or give up on the things that you love till you have figured out what is the kind of headache you have. We have lots of questions coming in. Okay, so Vaishali Harne Karle says, hello, Dr. Raashi. Hi, Vaishali. Could you suggest a few solutions for headaches due to the muscle spasms, as I think I have these kind of headaches for the last 15 years? Vaishali, this is one of the best questions that I have been asked today. Not that the others were not nice, but this is a very relevant question. Again, once you have identified that you do have muscle spasms, you have to figure out why you have got the muscle spasms in the body and why your body has not been able to heal it so far. I'll give you an example. I'm sitting in Hinduja Hospital, Mahim, right now. If I am told to go running from here to Gateway of India and back, I will probably be able to do it over 8-9 hours. But then my body will pain tomorrow, day after, the third day, the fourth day onwards, my body will begin to heal and the pain will get better and better and better. So all muscle spasms, again, the creator has made us beautifully look after themselves. However, muscle spasms that are not looking after themselves and are not self-healing is 100% due to some kind of chronic activity that is being done by you, which is leading to them remaining in your body, which could be something as simple as, number one, sitting in an odd position because of a neck issue, number two, grinding or chewing at subconsciously. A lot of people who are bruxers, a lot of people who clench their teeth without realizing how badly they're doing, can actually lead to the compression of muscles of their jaw as well as of their neck, which could also lead to these headaches. Now, often for those patients, they will also hear a tuck tuck or some kind of krr krr sound inside their jaw joint. I'll be happy to talk a little bit about the jaw as well in some time, if many of you all are interested in hearing about that. But coming back to what could have led to the muscle spasms, so we spoke about the para-functional habits, that is grinding, sitting in weird positions, people who are bodybuilders or boxers, when they are constantly clenching can lead to that as well. People who are palm chewers, constantly grinding, chewing gum, or even people who have sinuses that are blocked, they accommodate by sitting in a particular position, which worsens the muscle spasms over time. Sleep apnea, sleep disorders can also contribute to it. Now, till you don't eliminate the reason why your body has held on to the muscle spasms, we will not be able to get a resolution. So identifying that is paramount. Second thing, there are a lot of people who may not have parafunctional habits, but may have physical body conditions, like general conditions, where their body doesn't allow them or their muscles to heal at the rate which would be considered normal, right? So conditions like fibromyalgia or connective tissue disorders, and we can diagnose those for you, or a high uric acid, or if there is borderline thyroid, these can contribute to the muscles not healing in totality as well. So I'll be very happy if you want, please come over to Hinduja. Let me diagnose what's the reason why you've had muscle spasm for 15 years. I think it's terrible that you've had chronic pain for that long. And let us help figure out what we can do for you. I'm really happy you put forward that question, because I'm sure it was very useful for many. Medically, we can do a lot to take care of these muscle spasms, from something as simple as physiotherapy, which is going to realign your spine so that the load stops going on your muscles, ranging to muscle relaxants, which are allopathic medication, which are not conventional painkillers, but medicines which stretch out the muscles, as well as eliminating those spasms by the use of trigger point injections, which is a modified allopathic version of acupuncture to break those spasms, will give you a lot of relief as well. So like I explained to you, the trigger points are the points of contraction, right? Number one, the muscle relaxants will stretch it out. Number two, the physio will keep it in the right position to make sure that it doesn't ever relapse back to giving you headaches. And number three, whichever deep, stubborn spasms don't go away, we can open them out by using sports acupuncture or trigger point injections. And that should give you a lot of relief as well. So I'm glad you brought that up. Of course, you have to remember that home care is paramount. Till you don't care, take care of whatever has led to you getting those spasms, it's going to come back. So, we are going to take any more questions? Are we done with the questions? Well, we have a lot of questions coming in, but my team is telling me that if I continue to talk over here, I'll probably be sitting here all night. As you all can see, I'm really passionate about what I do. I'm one of the lucky people, blessed, who has got to do what she loves to do, which is to help all of y'all and contribute to y'all to make y'all pain-free, hopefully, and get y'all to live a better quality of life. If y'all have any more questions, if y'all want to come and see me, if you want to figure out what to do with your headaches, if you can't manage it on your own, and if you can't diagnose and figure it out after this conversation that we had, please reach out to me. I'll be happy to help you guys out. It was a pleasure. Thank you.